Good morning and welcome to the First Christian Church of North Hollywood and our online service of worship. We're so glad that you joined us today. During our service, Jennifer will be leading in our children's moment, so have the children ready to enjoy this very special time of the service that's just for them. Pastor Alfredo will be leading us in our moments of prayer, and Pastor Louise will be leading us in our observation of Holy Communion. So please have those elements that remind you of the bread and the wine ready so that you can partake at that particular time. So now let us continue as we worship together.
Everyone prays in the end. Oh, I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I have never believed in you, no, but I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I have never believed in you, no, but I'm gonna pray.
Hey everybody, this is the time that we come to the Lord with thanksgiving, with joy, but sometimes we do with worries, with problems, situations that it's a burden to our life. But the scriptures say, don't worry about it, anything, instead pray about everything. So that's what we do at this time. We come to the Lord in praying. You and God knows what is going on in your life. So I invite you to join with me in praying in this time. Not in silent. This time I invite you to do it out loud. We come together and God will take care of us. Let us pray. Amantísimo Dios, we come to you with our thanksgiving because you are being good to us. You bless us every day we are here. We come to you with joy, knowing that you are our Lord, but we come to you with problems, with worriness, with situations that are not easy. These weeks are being so hard for many people, but we trust that you are taking care of us. We trust that you are bringing peace to this world, to this community, to this country, to our families, and to our lives. We thank you for every blessing, because every day we might not notice it, but you bless us in the ways that we just enjoy it, and sometimes we don't count it, but help us to count our blessings day by day. Please help us to be a pacifier. Please help us to be a light in this world. Help us to be the person that will bring the right word to those in need. Help us to be your truly disciples. And we do this in Jesus' name. We pray according to what he teach his disciples. When he told them, when you pray, pray this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our debts as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All the children come forward for children's message, please. Today I want to talk to you about faith and trust. So in the Bible, in Psalms verse 23, it kind of sounds like David has been asked the question, who do you trust? And his answer is, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. David was a shepherd, and he knew that the sheep could trust him in any situation. If the sheep were hungry, the shepherd would take them to green pastures where they had plenty to eat. And if the sheep were thirsty, the shepherd would take them to a gentle stream where the sheep could drink. And if the sheep were in danger of being eaten by wild animals, the shepherd was there to protect them. The sheep knew that the shepherd were there to help them in every situation that they faced. And sometimes we find ourselves facing difficult situations and we have difficult choices to make, and we ask ourselves, who can we trust? And the answer is Jesus. The Bible tells us that Jesus is the good shepherd and we are his sheep. Just like David, we can say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We can trust him in every situation. But it's not always easy to have faith and trust. And I want to show you what it's like to have faith and trust in God. So I need a volunteer to help me illustrate what faith and trust looks like. And once again, since none of you are available to help volunteer, I've asked my son Cole to come and help me. Everybody say hi, Cole.
Hello.
Okay, Cole. So here's what you're gonna have to do. You trust me, right?
Yes.
Okay. So when I say you trust me, what I mean is I need you to listen to me very carefully and then do exactly what I tell you to do. Can you do that?
Yes.
Okay, great. So the first thing I want you to do is this. Okay, good. Now I want you to pat your head and rub your tummy. Good, and now can you rub your head and pat your tummy? That one's kind of hard. And can you put your hands in your armpits and flap them and go, I'm a chicken.
I'm a chicken.
Okay, good. So it looks to me like you're really good at following directions. So now what I want you to do is I want you to put your hands out straight in front of you just like this, okay? And you're gonna put a cup in this hand, and then you're gonna put a cup in that hand, and you're gonna leave them straight out in front of you, okay?
Okay.
And just to make it interesting, I'm going to add water to the cup. And water to this cup, okay? And then I'm gonna take this cup, and you're gonna keep holding this cup straight out in front of you. You can put this cup down. Okay, so now what I want you to do is, no, leave the cup straight in front of you. I'm gonna show you what to do first, and then you're gonna follow me, okay?
Okay.
So you're gonna take the cup from straight out in front of you. Just follow me, don't do it yet.
Okay.
You're gonna put the cup on top of your head. You're gonna close your eyes, and then you're slowly going to turn in a circle, and then you're gonna put the cup straight out in front of you, and then you're gonna open your eyes. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, so this cup is straight out in front of you. You're gonna put the cup on your head. You're gonna close your eyes, and you're gonna slowly turn in a circle. Good, and then you're gonna put the cup straight out in front of you, and then you're gonna open your eyes. Okay, good. Now you trust me, right?
Yes.
Okay, so on the count of three, we're gonna take the cup and we're gonna tip it over the top of our heads, okay?
Okay.
Okay, ready?
Yes.
You trust me, right?
Yeah.
Okay, ready? One, two, three.
What?
Thank you very much.
What?
That's called faith and trust.
What?
Let's do an echo prayer. Ready? Dear God.
Dear God.
You are the good shepherd.
You are the good shepherd.
And we are your sheep.
And we are your sheep.
We put our trust in you.
We put our trust in you.
Amen.
Amen.
Today's scripture comes out of the book of Luke. I'll be reading chapter 17, verses 11 through 17. It reads, "Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus travels along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, 'Jesus, Master, have pity on us.' He saw them and he said, 'Go show yourselves to the priests.' And they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, 'Were not all our other 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It has been another rather rough week in our city and in our nation. It seems that we are engaged in two very important battles. On the one hand, we are still fighting the coronavirus, trying to ease out of the shelter-at-home mode and self-quarantine and re-enter into our communities, our stores, our places of employment. And then on the other hand, we are fighting to support our Black brothers and sisters in their cry for justice and equality. Both of these battles are life-changing, and they carry enormous ramifications for the future of our society. Prejudice, inequality, and violence to another human being are never acceptable under any circumstances. Acts of violence toward others, because of race, ethnicity, sexuality, or religious beliefs are never acceptable, no matter what the justification. The prophet Amos, in the 8th century before Jesus, gave us words that still resonate with those who fight against human prejudice and injustice. He said, "But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." Since the murder of George Floyd, the streets of major cities throughout the entire world have been filled with demonstrators. Some of our own church family have been marching, carrying placards, singing, speaking to anyone who would listen about their concerns about Black men and women dying at the hands of untrained, impulsive, and often emotionally unstable law enforcement officers. As I said, prejudice, inequality, and violence to another human being are never acceptable under any circumstances. Unfortunately, such prejudice and inequality and violence knows no bounds. It reaches into the heart of every community, of every race, of every ethnicity. And unfortunately, the ability of human beings to hate, to form class systems, to create systems of prejudice, to treat fellow human beings with disdain, with violence, disrespect, and hatred is as old as civilization itself. The Old Testament prophets had visions of society without injustices. They had visions without human mistreatment. Isaiah said, "The tyrant shall be no more. All those alert to do evil shall be cut off, those who deny justice to one in the night." It was no different in Jesus' day. Life was brutal under the rule of the Roman Empire. And in the Jewish faith, status was reserved for only a very few, for the religious upper class, and they jealously held on to their status, denying equality to everyone else. What that ruling religious class failed to realize was that Jesus had come to challenge that status, that social standing. Jesus' message was one of equality, and that regardless of one's race, wealth, social standing, physical appearance, you could be and were the recipient of God's grace and God's love. Luke's gospel tells the story of Jesus entering Jerusalem. As he made his way toward Jerusalem, he began to pass through the outskirts of the city, including Bethany, where his old friend Lazarus lived. He came to a point climbing up the hill near the Mount of Olives, where he could look over the Kidron Valley and view the great city and the temple beyond the city wall. It was near sundown, and as Jesus viewed the city, Luke said that Jesus wept. That is the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. And Jesus said, as if speaking to Jerusalem, "If even now, on this day, you knew those things that make for peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes." I believe Jesus wept because the people could not see the reality of the sacredness of life. Life that they did not understand, life with which they disagreed, the life of people whose actions they could not condone, even the life of those they hated, and perhaps especially those people, because they had the most to teach them. I believe that Jesus wept because his gospel of unconditional love had been rejected by the authorities and the teachers of his day, and instead, the teachings of judgment, of prejudice, of separation and inequality had been embraced and taught as a part of faith. I believe that Jesus wept on Monday, May 25th, at the horrific death of George Floyd. I believe Jesus wept and wept and wept some more. And as tears rolled down his cheeks, he saw the reaction of people around the world, and especially in our own nation. Shock, anger, heartbreak, the cry for justice, empathy, sympathy, compassion, disbelief, fear, and personal anxiety. And for followers of Jesus, the realization once again that Jesus was weeping as were each of us shook us to our very core. Jesus shared the love of God and welcomed person after person into his own life. Throughout the scriptures, we read of Jesus responding to everyone who asked for help. The crippled, the blind, the beggar, the Roman centurion, the temple ruler, Nicodemus, the Pharisee who came to him by night and followed Jesus. It made no difference to Jesus the social standing of a person, the color of their skin, their economic standing and wealth. Jesus' message was that we are all worthy to be called children of God. In 2016, Timothy Merrill, a minister, a writer, and editor, addressed his colleagues immediately following another horrific event. Dr. Merrill asked us a series of questions which address the events of that day. I feel they address very pointedly the events of our day, and so I would like to share them with you. He asked, can we agree? Can we agree that violence as a means of venting frustration is wrong? Can we agree that verbal violence sets a bad example for our children and youth and is not an acceptable means of communication? Can we agree that incivility and the lack of respect for people different from ourselves, whether because of race, political affiliation, sexual orientation, ethnicity, gender, religion, or handicap, often leads to human abuse? Can we agree that hate is a negative and harmful emotion? Can we agree that we can live as people of peace, renouncing verbal and physical violence in all forms? Can we agree that proactively initiating an act of kindness to someone who's radically different from us will bless both the giver and the receiver? Can we agree on the importance of Jesus' teaching? You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. These are questions that search our souls as we struggle to find peace. Andrew Dorf was a young man who was raised in our church. As a teenager, he worked in our church nursery with his grandmother. He was a wonderful person, a sensitive soul, a good friend, and an excellent songwriter. Andrew died at the age of 40 in a tragic accident, but he left us with some good advice. In 2010, he co-authored a visionary country western song with Tommy Lee James. It was recorded for the first time in 2011 to excellent reviews. It is entitled Bleed Red, and I think it speaks to us perhaps more today than when Andrew and Tommy wrote it. So in honor of my friend Andrew, I share these lyrics with you. Let's say we're sorry before it's too late. Give forgiveness a chance. Turn the anger into water. Let it slip through our hands. We all bleed red. We all taste rain, all fall down, lose our way. We all say words we regret. We all cry tears. We all bleed red. If we're fighting, we're both losing. We're just wasting our time because my scars, they are your scars, and your world is mine. You and I, we all bleed red. We all taste rain, fall down, lose our way. We all say words we regret. We all cry tears. We all bleed red. Let's say we're sorry before it's too late. Sometimes we're strong. Sometimes we're weak. Sometimes we're hurt, and it cuts deep. We live this life, breath to breath. We're all the same. We all bleed red. In March of 1964, in St. Louis, Missouri, Martin Luther King said, "We must all learn to live together as brothers, or we will all perish as fools." Now is the time. Now is the hour. Let Jesus' message of love and grace sink deep within your reality, and let us begin to live as brothers and sisters. Amen.
Morning. Well, here we are. It's almost 4 months into our new normal environment, and I, for one, am feeling unsettled. I feel like I'm in a waiting room. I'm waiting for somebody to give me the all clear signal so I can go ahead and meet with friends and be with family and do all the things that filled my days before. But of course, that's not happening, won't happen soon. And in the interim, so many concerns crowd my mind. And how could they not? We are living through a pandemic, an economic crisis, and we have just witnessed the raw brutality of racial injustice. When Jesus met with the disciples that last meal, he told them to wait. He told them that if they waited, they would receive a sign. And when they received that sign, he asked them to respond. How could we not think that God is giving us a signal, asking us to respond, because he's given us the tools to do it? Deep within our hearts and our minds and our souls is his love. And that gets reflected in everything we do, in our thoughts, in our words, in our actions. The Holy Spirit is within us. How comforting is that? One comfort that we all have is coming together every Sunday over a communion table. And yes, they're scattered all over, but really, we come together as one family. We come together and ask God to give us spiritual guidance, to give us the nurturing and the hope that we are all seeking now. We ask for his resilience so we may face whatever comes forward. And we ask that he gives us inspiration to practice Pastor Bob's three P's, prayer, peace, and patience. Ecclesiastes 9:7 told us, "Eat thy bread with joy and drink thy wine with a merry heart." No words of encouragement are more important than those today. Be well, church family.
We are gathered here at our family dining room table. And when we come together to celebrate the Lord's Supper, we gather at the church's dining room table that sits in the middle of our sanctuary chancel. It's a beautiful space. It's a welcoming place. And we know that everyone is invited to join us as we celebrate communion. So please have your communion elements by your side as we break bread and share this cup. When we gather, we remember that our Lord Jesus Christ gathered with his disciples in an upper room. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread. He blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them. And he said, "This is my body and it's for you. As often as you eat this, remember me." In the same way, he took a cup and he gave God thanksgiving. And he said, "In this is the blood of a new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Let us pray.
Loving God, this is your table. It is a table of peace. It is a table of welcome. It is a table of hope. It is a table where we receive nourishment, life, joy in one another. We give you thanks for this table. And we ask that you bless all who sit around it wherever they find themselves. We ask that you bless these elements of bread and cup to feed us, to strengthen us for the journey that is the week ahead. We give you thanks for all that it represents, for all that it gives, for all that you are. And in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you. Louise, the body and blood of Christ, broken and shed for you.
Amen.
During this time, there is so much uncertainty. It is easy to forget how much we are loved and blessed by our Lord and Savior. Each of us have been uniquely blessed, whether that blessing be in the form of unique talents, unique experiences, unique skills, or financial. They are all blessings that are best when shared with others, even more so in these uncertain times. As the children's song goes, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine." Please let us shine our light on others so they too can see the light. Please send your offering, which will allow us to continue to help others, to the address on the screen, or you can visit us directly at our website. If you're not able to give financially at this time, please contact us to let us know other ways that you can help by sharing in your unique blessings.
That brings us to the conclusion of our service of worship this morning. We're so glad that you joined us. We hope that you will tell your family and friends about this service. We'd love to have as many people as possible join us each Sunday. At the end of the service, there will be on the screen the various activities, times, and events of our church. We hope you will join us for as many as are convenient for you. And as we go into this next week, we ask for your prayers and for your support of our church. We continue our ministry here in North Hollywood and in the Los Angeles area, and also throughout the world. God bless you. Please join me for the benediction and then the congregational singing of "Let There Be Peace on Earth, and Let It Begin with Me." And now may the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, and lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and always. Amen.